Nice job, first graders. You made it back for the third video of the week with me, Ms. Boyle, and you, the awesome first graders. Give yourselves a high five on making it back for lesson number three. We have more to read in this book, Tooth, Throw Your Tooth on the Roof, Tooth Traditions from Around the World. So we've been talking a lot about what good readers do. And why do we do this? Why do we do these things that good readers do? Well, the reason is because we want to get information from the book. And we can get information from lots of different places in the book. We can get information from words, and we can get information from the pictures. So today, our focus, what we're going to be doing, is we are going to learn information from the words and the pictures. So here's our target, learn information from the words and pictures. We're going to learn some more tooth traditions by looking carefully at the pictures and listening carefully to the words. So here is our book again, Throw Your Tooth on the Roof, Tooth Traditions from Around the World. It is written by Selby V. Buehler and illustrated by G. Brian Karras. And we have learned a lot of tooth traditions. Look, you can see all my teacher post-its here. This is where I mark everything. And look, these are all the tooth traditions that we have talked about so far this week. Do you remember any of them? This is your chance that you get to say it out loud. What tooth tradition do you remember? Maybe it's your favorite one or the one that sticks out. Go ahead and say out loud to a real human or a pretend human or a pet. What tooth tradition do you remember from this book? Which one do you remember? I remember the Russia one because I did that visualization of that one where they put the tooth in the mouse hole. I remember there was the hopping on one foot. That was a fun tradition. That was a good one. I remember there was lots of rats. Rats showed up in a couple of different traditions, right? The rat who drank, or no, that was a mouse who drank the water and left behind money. And then there was a rat who left behind money. And then there was a bunny who took it and left behind money. Sounds like money is definitely something that gets left behind. We do that in the United States. I know a lot of people have a tooth fairy come and leave money. So did you remember some of the tooth traditions? There was a lot in here, and we still have not read all of them. And it would be really great that I think I might read some of this because I am really wondering about some of these other tooth traditions. So we're going to read a little bit more in this book, but it's not just tooth traditions in this book. The author and illustrator did something else that's really cool. They added some other things to this book besides just the traditions. So I wanted to show you one of the things that they added to this book. It's here at the end of the book. And it's right here. I'm gonna hold it up really close so that you can take a look at it. And it's right here. What do you see right there? You see it? This is a diagram. Now, there's lots of pictures in this book. But a diagram is a special type of picture. It's a picture that is very specifically there to teach you the parts of something. And one dead giveaway that it's a diagram is that you see labels. I know labels might be something that you've been doing in your writing. Well, right, that's because what writers do is they add labels. And here are some labels to the different parts of this tooth diagram. So this is a diagram about a tooth, right? So here, it's got different parts. It has tooth enamel, root, pulp, the root canal, the gum, the dentin. Oh, look, that's the dentin right there. And the crown. Now, I don't know some of these words because I'm not a dentist. I'm not a tooth expert. But the writer did something else that was really cool with this diagram, since the point of this diagram is to teach us, right? It's a picture that teaches. So there up here are definitions. These are meanings of the different words. So like I know the word crown, like what a princess wears is a crown. I don't know about crown on a tooth. So I can go up here and I can see right here, it says crown, the part of the tooth you can see. It is covered by enamel. Oh, so that's the white stuff. Oh, and there it is. It says tooth enamel. So that's the white stuff. So this is the crown and it's covered by tooth enamel. There you go. So what did you learn about the crown? Go ahead and say it out loud. Can you point to your crown of your teeth? How many crowns? Our teeth are royalty. They have so many crowns on them. Ba-dum-bum-tsh. All right. There was another word in this diagram that I hadn't heard before that I am wondering about, which is, of course, what good readers do. Dentin. I've never heard of dentin before. And I saw that that was right there, labeling dentin. So I'm going to go up to this definition, and I'm going to read the definition of dentin. Dentin, the main part of the tooth beneath the crown and surrounding the root. Dentin is harder than bone, but softer than enamel. Good to know. So it's kind of that in-between part. It's kind of like the jelly in between the crown and the root. All right, so we were able to learn about dentin. So this diagram was super helpful because it really was a picture that helped teach us. And so I was able to learn information from this picture. I'll learn a lot of information, but also the words, right? Because the definitions were also helpful. So I was able to learn a lot of information from this picture and these words. Thank you so much for doing that along with us and being a good reader. There is another part. Remember I said this doesn't just have tooth traditions in it. It has a lot of tooth traditions. But it also has here at the very end an author's note. Have you ever seen an author's note before? They usually appear at the back or sometimes at the front of books. And it's written directly from the author, kind of saying like how they feel about the book or why they wrote the book or what they want you to feel about the book. And both fiction and nonfiction books can have an author's note. And I like author's notes because I think writers are amazing. Like writers that publish books are just like magicians. And so I like the author's note because it kind of gives you like an inside peek into their brain about why they wrote the book and how they wrote the book and how they feel about the book. So it's kind of like opening that writer's brain and seeing what they were thinking. So let's read this author's note. She wrote a cute little picture, or the illustrator probably drew a cute little picture of slippers and the mouse, probably referring back to one of those other traditions. So author's note. When I was a child and I lost a baby tooth, I put it under my pillow and waited for the tooth fairy. Oh, connection, right? When my own children lost their teeth, I taught them to do the same thing. This was the only tooth tradition I knew. It's the only tooth tradition I knew too. Are you like that? One day, as my daughter talked about the tooth fairy, a friend from Brazil overheard her and asked, "What's a tooth fairy?" Her question surprised me. "If you haven't heard of the tooth fairy," I asked my friend, "what did you do when you lost your baby teeth?" Her response sparked my interest, which means made me excited, sparked my interest in finding out what children all over the world do when they lose their teeth. So this author thought that everybody had the tooth fairy. And then she heard that this girl from Brazil didn't have the tooth fairy and she got super curious. I quickly discovered that the best way to learn what people do with their baby teeth is simply to ask them. While collecting customs or traditions for this book, I stopped people wherever I went. I smiled, introduced myself, and asked them the question I had asked my friend. What did you do with your baby teeth when you lost them? Sorry, I'm just visualized that for a second. I pictured this woman coming up that like I wouldn't, you know, that doesn't know this person, just going up and be like, "Hey, what'd you do with your baby teeth?" That's a pretty funny visualization. She was pretty brave to go around and ask that so many times. I talked to people on the street, in stores, in taxi cabs, and airplanes, and buses. I visited the embassies of many nations in Washington, D.C., and wrote letters and email to people at universities, cultural centers, and UNICEF offices all over the world. So lots of, like, big government offices where there's people from all over the world. She wrote to all of those people and talked to all those people. The willingness of strangers to answer my unusual question, whether asked in person or by a note on the internet, was heartwarming. That heartwarming means it warmed her heart. The friendliness and humor with which they shared their stories made doing this research both fascinating and fun. In Throw Your Tooth on the Roof, I have been able to include only a small number of the hundreds and hundreds of tooth traditions to be found around the world. Choosing was not easy. A single country often has many different traditions, and a single tradition is often shared by many different countries. I've tried to show both the wide variety and the similarity of tooth customs everywhere. We did that, right? When we were talking about the same and different, how they were the same and different, we did that last video. Well, that's what she chose. She wanted us to kind of see how some tooth traditions were the same and how how they're different. I wish to send enormous thanks to every person around the globe who so graciously took the time to answer my questions. Without your kind and generous help, Throw Your Tooth on the Roof would never have been possible. That was kind of fun to see, like, what was going on in her writer's brain as they were doing that. So what did we learn from the author's note? Go ahead and say it out loud. So what did you learn? We learned, like, how she figured this all out. Her research was kind of fun. She just got to go around and talk to people and ask them. Kind of brave for going around and asking a bunch of strangers. Do you think you could do it? I don't know if I could do it. So why did she become interested in other tooth traditions? Do you remember? Yeah, because she thought everybody did the tooth fairy. And then she had that friend from Brazil and they didn't have the tooth fairy. And she became very curious about this. So wasn't that cool reading that author's note to kind of see a peek? And we were able to learn, not really a tooth tradition, but we kind of learned about the author and how she came up with all of these, or how she made this book, how she found all these different tooth traditions. And we were able to learn information from the author's own words, which learning information, of course, is something that good readers do. So first graders, I would love for you to now think of a book that you're going to go grab where you can learn information from the words and pictures. Can be a nonfiction book, but it can also be fiction if you need it to be. And you are going to spend, of course, how long? 15 minutes independently reading that book. Then at the end, you're going to write a journal entry. And in that journal entry, you're going to write the title, what the book is about, and what you learned from the words and pictures. So here is my journal entry that I already completed about this book. And you might have a sheet that looks like this. Once again, if you don't have a sheet that looks like this, blank piece of paper works totally fine too, as long as you put the title, what the book is about, and what you learned from the words or pictures. So here, just to give you an example of my journal entry, I wrote, I read Throw Your Tooth on the Roof. It's about tooth traditions. I learned that there's lots of different tooth traditions all around the world. So it's just a few sentences talking about the book and what I learned, because learning information from the words and pictures is what good readers do. All right, first graders, you made it. This is the end of the week, the end of this lesson for all of this week. Thank you so much for watching, first graders. This has been great. Keep making discoveries, keep reading, keep having fun, keep giving lots of hugs to your family. Know that your teachers super, 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 super miss you. Bye.